morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Cambridge Union Society. There are a few brief announcements before we start tonight. There are to be no cameras, no phones, and no recording of any kind, either oral or visual. Please remain in your seats at all times until the end of the talk and questions. And finally, any disruption of the event is in violation of the Union's constitution as set out in both your membership and your ticket. If you attempt to disrupt this event, you will be asked to leave immediately and subject to a number of potential penalties, including revocation of membership. Dominique Strauss-Kahn is a French economist and politician. He served as the managing director of the International Monetary Fund from 2007 to 2011, having previously been a professor of economics at Sciences Po and the French Minister of Economy and Finance. He will be speaking on the global financial climate and, in particular, globalization and the Eurozone. Please join me in welcoming Dominique Strauss-Kahn.
Well, thank you. I would first to thank all of you for having invited me, and especially Daddy Lamb and the Standing Committee of the Cambridge Union Society. I understand it creates some emotion, which I'm very sorry about, and I hope that you will not keep me responsible for the noise. Well, I have been asked, and I'm happy to talk to you about globalization and the Eurozone, and I decided to do so through using a tale of three trilemmas. Policy trilemmas always been a very potent way to describe the economic policy trade-off, and some trilemma are especially powerful to understand our current predicament and our future challenges. So I will present three of them, which I found particularly useful to understand the world economies these days and to provide hints for solution. These three trilemmas are totally independent from each other, but in another way they're deeply interconnected, and I think it's useful to think of them concurrently as a system. The first one is very well known by economists, especially international economists, maybe there's some among you. It's known since the beginning of the 60s as the Mundell-Fleming one. It has always been a very important reference for international economists. And the idea is the following. It posits that an economy cannot simultaneously have an independent monetary policy and an open current account, a capital account. The capital account is the account where you have inflows and outflows of capital, and a fixed exchange rate. You have to choose. You can have two of them, whatever the one you choose, but you cannot have the three of them. That's the trilemma. And this idea has been the key justification for liberalization of capital movement, telling the countries, accept the flexibility of your exchange rate, and then you have to open your capital account, because if not, you won't be able to have an independent monetary policy. So you have to choose the three. It has also a lot of important consequences for the international monetary system, which, as you know, evolved gradually after the end of the Bretton Woods Agreement to a kind of a non-system, loosely governed by an implicit anchor, namely the US dollar, and the supposed disciplining and the stabilizing effect of these flexible exchange rates and free movement of capital. What we found out subsequently, and I must say painfully from the end of the 90s until now, is that the stabilizing features of this non-system were much weaker than initially thought. And there are many reasons for that. Some at the micro level. I will not spend too much time on this, namely that we don't understand very well the imperfect nature of financial market, also our underestimation of the consequences of financial friction, our deliberate dismissal of the impact of asset bubbles, as you have seen in many countries like Spain with the housing market recently, and if I may use a barbaric word, our disregard for behavioral macroeconomics, as if macroeconomics was just technique and no behavior, no human behavior in this. But at this micro reason, there are other reasons, macro reasons, which are, in my view, at the same time, simpler and more important. The idea was that on the paper, you have a stabilizing system if it's what the economists call general equilibrium. It means that it has to be applied internationally and systematically, and then it works. The problem is that it didn't happen, and part of the world, and not a small part of the world, China, India, half of the population of the world, and also the most dynamic economies, didn't follow the rule, at least didn't say it's correct rules. When I say didn't follow the rules, as if they were cheating. I'm not saying that. I say they didn't accept this kind of system. So what we fail to acknowledge is that a large part of the world refused to adopt this model. The model would have worked if everybody played the same game, but for a reason, bad or wrong, a large part of the world decided not to do this. And the contradiction between this theory of the international monetary system, flexible exchange rate, open capital accounts, and independent monetary policy, the contradiction between this and the reality has been one of the main sources of instability and today justifies a profound reform. This has been the subject of a large amount of research over years. The main point being this underlying assumption that there was a consensus to go in this direction, while this consensus didn't exist. It was the consensus proposed by advanced economies, but most emerging economies were not part of the consensus. It just didn't accept the idea that they had to go on with what has been decided by the advanced economies. So the consensus never happened, but we behaved as if there was a consensus. And even after the Asian crisis, some of you may remember the Asian crisis at the end of the 90s, after when the Asian crisis has been fixed, it was obvious that most Asian countries will not follow this track. They will follow another track with fixed exchange rate, which has advantages and drawbacks. We may discuss hours about that. Well, the point is, they didn't follow the track which was prepared as the only one which goes on with globalization. And again, we act as if the system, the plan worked and the things goes on. So today, we need to accept to look at the world not only with our own glasses, but with the glasses of everybody. And obviously, the consensus is still lacking. There's a consensus on some part of international economics and this Mundell-Fleming trilemma, but not everything. The consensus exists on one thing first. I will quote two. One is that one currency, and especially a currency of a country, the economy of which is likely to become relatively less prominent, is not an optimal solution. And you cannot rely for the world economy only on one currency being the anchor. So it calls either for another currency to be the anchor, but frankly, nobody see who could replace the dollar. And the idea that the renminbi, the Chinese renminbi, could do this, is, I don't know what's going to happen in 2 centuries from now, but it's obviously not relevant for today. Or you can go to a new, truly multi-currency system, but then it means that part of the anchors are certainly the dollar, but also the euro, also the renminbi, let's say maybe the pound, maybe the yen, and it's a multi-system, that it means that everybody accepts that it's only part of the system. Or there's a third solution, of course, which is a bit idealistic, which is a very well-known old solution by Keynes, the bancor, which he proposed at the end of World War II, which was only one currency for everybody, but that's not going to happen anytime soon. Some people say, maybe you have read this, that the SDR, the special drawing rights, which are created by the IMF, could become this special currency. There's certainly a bigger role to play for the SDRs, and if you want me to answer questions about this later on, I will do it with pleasure. But as it stands, the SDR are not really a currency, and it's a kind of a dream to believe that the SDR could replace and become this international currency. So, back to reality, if be based on the dollar only is not a good solution, then we need to go to the only thing which is practical, which is this kind of a set of five, six, four, I don't know, international currency that will work together.